Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure and privilege to invite you all to the fourth Dr. Yellapragada Subba Rao Memorial Lecture today on 16th of August 2017 at Sir C.V. Raman Auditorium in University of Hyderabad. And here, this is Malika. I'm doing my fifth year integrated MSc in Optometry and Vision Sciences from School of Medical Sciences. I take this opportunity to extend my warm welcome on behalf of School of Medical Sciences. School of Medical Sciences is hosting Dr. Yellapragada Subba Rao Memorial Lecture for past 4 years. A warm welcome to all the special invitees, guests and friends of School of Medical Sciences. Thank you all for being here for this special occasion. We are honored this afternoon by the presence of our VC Dr. Professor Apara Podile, and Dean School of Medical Sciences, Dr. Geeta K. Vemuganti ma'am, and Dr. P.R. Krishnaswamy, and you all of from the University of Hyderabad campus. May I take this opportunity to invite a distinguished guest to the dais, Dr. P.R. Krishnaswamy sir, and Professor Apara Podile, and Dr. Geeta K. Vemuganti.
A very warm welcome to all of you, and I have to reiterate that it's an honor and pleasure that we have to host this lecture, which was initiated almost 15-20 years ago. But the School of Medical Sciences, after its inception, the responsibility of holding this prestigious lecture was given to us, and we are honored and humbled by this privilege that we received. So I'm sure many of you are already familiar with it, but can you just move the slide, please? Can you? Doctor, how many of you know about Dr. Yellapragada Subba Rao garu? Okay, thank you. That's a good thing, because out of sight, out of mind, that's the attitude most of us have. But I'm happy to see the raised hands. So we have this memorial, this photograph of Dr. Subba Rao garu, who was born on 12th January 1895, the last century, and died on August 9th, 1948. And in his honor, because we wanted to have it either in January or August, and we decided that we would continue it in August. And while we start this, may I request Dr. Krishnaswamy garu to kindly garland the photograph. As you have noted, he was born in Bhimavaram, and subsequently he moved to US for a long time. Can you please keep moving the slides, please? And he was born to a Telugu family. His life is very inspiring, and which Bhimavaram was earlier in the Madras presidency, as you would now know, and now in West Godavari. And he had some traumatic experience while he was doing schooling. And he matriculated in his third attempt. So those students, this is a message I always try to give, that one failure and we get so disappointed. And here is a legend who never bothered about counting how many attempts he made. And he passed his intermediate from the Presidency College and went to enter the Madras Medical College. But he was a Gandhian by philosophy. And I am now hesitant to talk about him, because a person who knows him, he's here. And I would request Dr. Krishnaswamy to correct anything that I have entered here based on the information that I have from the website. Obviously, I never crossed roads with him. And he started wearing khadi for the call Mahatma Gandhi gave. Subsequently, because of that, though he did well in his exams, And he was awarded a lesser degree, they called it at that time, what is called LMS, and not a full MBBS. And he tried to get into the Madras Medical Services, but couldn't get. He took up a job as a lecturer in the anatomy department in an Ayurvedic college in Madras. And he was fascinated by the Ayurvedic powers of healing. He had the turning point in his life. Most of us have a turning point. And that turning point in his life was when he met Dr. American doctor from Rockefeller Scholarship, and who prompted him to take up this follow support. And from Malladi Satyalingam Naikar Charities in Kakinada. And they were the supporters for his travel to Boston. And subsequently, Dr. Subbaram ended up marrying his daughter. Next one. So he did his diploma from Harvard Medical School and then joined the same institute as a junior faculty. And one of the important, I think those of you from biochemistry would realize the importance of estimation of phosphorus in body fluids and tissues. He was instrumental in developing that. And he discovered the role of phosphocreatinine and ATP in muscle activity. Again, that's source of energy is that's what helps us explain many activities. He obtained his PhD the same year. He joined the Lederle Labs. In fact, when I was talking to Dr. Govardhan Mehta, he was remembering that he was part of the American cyanamide company, which is now a division of the Wyeth, which is owned by Pfizer. And he was denied a regular position at Harvard. So, and subsequently, he went on to, how many of you know about folic acid? Yes. So, folic acid it has been used as a double-edged sword, the only tablet which is given in the first trimester. In fact, preconception, even first pregnancy, first trimester is also too late for folic acid to be given. It has to be given preconception. And that again, if you use a tool to act against a folic acid, you have a cancer drug. And that's exactly what happened. To isolate folic acid was as an anemia he had worked on. And then obviously, logically, he went to the best way of attacking that and led to a cancer drug, the methotrexate, one of the very first and the basis of anti-cancer treatment. There are many other discoveries, hitrazone for filariasis, which is now a WHO approved drug. He helped Benjamin Dugger in 1945, and the tetracyclines that we know of is again his contribution. And a fungus is named after him, and that's called Subramyces splendens in the honor of the American, in his honor by named by American cyanamide. So many of us believe that he did not get the due credit or the laurels that he should have got, and they believe that they are obscured by achievements of others and his own failure to promote oneself, and lack of efforts to protect his IPR. I believe now everyone, whenever we talk about any new thing, we say, have you protected your IPR? It's coming part of our training, but I guess that it was not as important at that time. And there are no interviews, no claims, no lecture tours. And I would request Dr. Krishnaswamy to again, before he starts, to elaborate on that. And there were many nucleotides discovered by him. And this is his, next one please. So there is a writing in the April issue of Arogyasri, which was observed about him, that you probably never heard of Dr. Yellapragada Subbarao, yet because he lived, you may be alive today and are well today. And because he lived, you may live longer. And that is one of the best ways we can pay our tributes to this man. And the privilege of today's lecture is that we have Dr. Krishnaswamy, who had crossroads with him. So whenever we go to tours, we touch a table, any shooting is done or someone has stayed there, we look at it with more interest. So that's the reason I am excited that Dr. Krishnaswamy, who crossed paths with him, is here. And I thank Professor Parao Garu, who has spared his time to be with us. And I would now request him to give his invitation. Followed that, I will give the I'll introduce the speaker and he will continue his talk. Thank you very much for being here with us today.
Professor Krishnaswamy, chief guest for the and the speaker for this year's Yellapragada Subba Memorial Lecture. Professor Geeta Vemaganti, faculty colleagues, Professor Murlidhar, students and other invited guests. It's a rich tradition, in my opinion, that the University of Hyderabad has set up to honor this great scientist, Dr. Yellapragada Subba Rao, and before medical sciences has taken over, it was School of Life Sciences which was conducting this memorial lecture, which was coordinating that rather. And every time we made an effort to find a person who knows closely about Dr. Subba Rao's work, but this time we are fortunate that we have someone who has very closely known him. He's like Professor Krishnaswamy is with us to share his experiences and his views on the contributions made by Dr. Yellapragada Subba Rao. This is a very good opportunity for all of us to recap the scientific achievements of our scientists of Indian origin, and particularly those who have made significant contributions, and some of them which may not have come to limelight as much as they should have been, but nevertheless, then once it is reported, they get their due credit. I can tell you, although the method he has developed is for to measure it in the plasma or the in the blood, the same method the plant biology people, everybody will use when we want to measure the inorganic phosphate. So it's a very popular method, whatever he has developed those days. And we would like to really, as on behalf of university, I would like to thank Professor Krishnaswamy for taking his time and traveling from Bangalore to Hyderabad, especially for this purpose. And it's a great honor, sir, to have you here with us. And I don't want to be between you and the audience for this particular distinguished lecture about Professor Yellapragada Subba Rao Memorial Lecture. Thank you very much, and Geeta to continue. She may have to give a brief introduction about our speaker first before he delivers the lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Dr. Patnam R. Krishnaswamy Garu. He is an eminent biochemist. Actually, as I said, again, I am hesitant to read all this, but to summarize, he is a biochemist. He is a clinician, almost a clinician, because they have contributed to the building of the labs in all the institutions that he has worked with. And that is why he is part of the clinical team, is what I would say. And he has... he's a chemical pathologist and a vast experience, Jasblok Hospital, Manipal, you name, and he has been involved in building up this. He is not only active in clinical services and research, but he is an institution builder and with long experience in administration in hospitals, laboratories and research centers in India. His work of four decades has won him several achievements and new innovations in the development and introduction of tests, especially in diabetes. How many of you have heard about glycosylated hemoglobin? Okay. So when you get hurt or any clot forms, how many days it takes to dissolve the clot? Few weeks. So glycosylated hemoglobin is something like that. The hemoglobin, he will talk about it, the hemoglobin gets glycosylated with the glucose, and that's a reflection of it will reflect for 3 months control of diabetes. And that, if you talk any lay person today who is a diabetic or who is associated with a diabetic patient, they will say in layman's language, there is one test which says last 3 months lo etla control undi ani. And that is the layman's understanding of what a glycosylated hemoglobin means. They know that one test is not reliable. Last 3 months reflection is in this test. And he's instrumental in developing this. And in many other tumor markers, hemoglobinopathies, infectious diseases, diagnosis, immunology. And he's an alumnus of Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, from where he his work from that place earned him a doctorate of science, which was given by Mysore University. And he had association with several institutes in US, the Tufts Medical University and Cornell University, Lowell Cancer Research Foundation, and many other. In addition to the glycosylated hemoglobin, his contribution to the mechanistic enzymology of glutamine and metabolism of glutathione, there are many biochemical investigations that he contributed to. And he has guided 14 PhD students, and when he was doing his, he was with his PhD work, he told me about 13 papers that he had in international, which led to the degree of doctorate of science. And his focus, as I mentioned in the beginning, Dr. Yellapragada Subbarao focused on translational research. And his research has been directly translational, as I just gave you. He has patents on recombinant insulin and protein separation innovations. And his expertise contributions extend both into the academic field, industry, patents, medicine, teaching, diagnostic, everything. So, and he's a true believer. While I was discussing with him, he was mentioning the dissociation that we see now between basic sciences, the preclinical subjects, the paraclinical we used to call it, and the clinical subjects. And that's the reason why he has chosen this. Those which are, this topic is very eye-catching, and I leave it to him to elaborate on that. And he is one of the feathers in his cap was he's a special invitee to the Nobel Award ceremony in 1985. In physiology and medicine, and he has various distinguished positions, including chief of pathology laboratories at Jaslok Hospital, Mumbai, founder director of Malia Hospital, later director Sagar Hospital, Bangalore, and he was instrumental in Manipal Hospital. Those who know, one of the fantastic labs where you have very state of art facilities, he was instrumental in setting that up, and with the very high volume services which they provide. And he's presently associated functionally as an advisor, adjunct faculty to many medical and biomedical institutions. And he was awarded the honorary degree of doctorate of science by the Devraj Urs MD by Devraj Urs Academy of Higher Education and Research for his contribution in medical research. And he has a lot to share with us. Thank you very much, sir, for taking time to give your lecture here. With that, I invite Dr. Krishnaswamy to give his lecture, please. Thank you very much.
Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Parao, Dr. Geeta, senior faculty, students, I'm a little embarrassed by the very long introduction. If you are born in 1929 and go through the educational process to make a living in addition to enjoying what you do, given the history of that period between 1929 and now, the vagaries of the requirements of special skills needed for various things associated with science, associated with medicine, associated with postgraduate activity, so forth, has taken me along courses that she described. And during the passage in those courses, I think I gathered some dust, but I also gathered some very, very precious things. And that is what makes that story a little interesting. I am very, very grateful to this university, Dr. Geeta, the Vice Chancellor, to have given me this opportunity to participate. I am not saying that I am giving a big address or anything. I think I am participating very humbly and in all modesty, the celebration of a person from this country who blazed a trail during a period in the history of modern medicine, along with the brightest stars about whom you might have heard or not heard, because in science, all you get at the end of your work and at the end of your life is a small footnote, if you are lucky. Or if you are lucky, by accident, something gets named after your, you discover a stain, you know, that stain is forever called after your name. But these are incidental. But I think the contributions you make to science are mainly anonymous. Therefore, I think it becomes very important. Today I want to address as much as possible most of the things I say to students particularly. And I think when you address students, it just reaches the faculty as well. I want to do this because in the perception of any activity, human activity like modern science, we take it for granted these things really appeared like that. Because of certain developments which may not be related to them. But I think today I would like to take the occasion to address the students these certain observations that I have made by studying, understanding, and also I think to have had the privilege of participating to a very modest extent during my career as a postdoctoral fellow, research fellow, or a visiting scientist, or a visiting professor, or whatever, and also in this country functioning to fulfill some requirements of my employers, who thought the science I knew was useful for something or the other. Having said all this, I want to dedicate this occasion where I have this opportunity to another unknown scientist, very good friend of mine, a scientist physician, Satya Reddy, who is no more with us. Satya Reddy was from Vizagapatnam. He was a medical graduate from Guntur, having obtained his MD degree in pediatrics. And during the great passage of many people from this country in medicine who migrated plane loads to the North American continent, he preceded them by a couple of years and spent a little time in Montreal and later in Toronto. And he was among the first neonatologists in the pediatric profession. He distinguished himself very well by being a great neonatologist, but I think equally so, he distinguished himself during the later part of his career because of his passion for science which was kindled in him when he was a medical student in Guntur by Yellapragada Subba. I have not met too many people whose passion to understand Yellapragada Rao's not only contributions, his persona, you know, what he was, how he was made up, his entire attitudes, his ideology, his personal life, his convictions and others. He made a very thorough study of it, and he was inspired to go to the North American continent entirely by his study of Yellapragada Subba Rao. And in fact, Satya, as I used to call him, he's no more. He had a brain tumor and passed away last year. He wanted to really do medicine, serve people, because he was a great humanist, but he also wanted to follow Subba Rao's footsteps and do something in science which would distinguish himself. He was not a chemist. But believe it or not, if you look at the papers, as it has happened in the case of Yellapragada Subba Rao, many people didn't raise the hands when we said, how many of you know? And I think if we had asked this question perhaps another 20 years ago, they would not, even those one or two hands would not have gone up, because nobody knows. But now internet is full of Yellapragada Subba Rao's every detail that you can imagine. But one request I make to all the young students, please after this lecture, devote some time to go through the net and read his life story. Not just science, read his life. I think it is worth it. So Satya Reddy kept Subba Rao as his model and distinguished himself as an expert in vitamin D research. In fact, today there are 6 or 7 people in the world who are recognized as modern day vitamin D experts, and Satya Reddy was one of them. He learnt his organic chemistry himself, put with his hands, he worked, and he had an enterprise in Brown University in Rhode Island in the United States as a full professor. He would devote 50% of his time for vitamin D research. So profound was his contribution. The Journal of Biological Chemistry had him on the editorial board. You can understand, you know, to get on the editorial board of Journal of Biological Chemistry is a very uphill task. You can't really get there. But Satya, who was not a biochemist, who was an MD, was one of the editors of the Journal of Biological Chemistry. And he also got a world prize for being the most distinguished vitamin D researcher. Unfortunately, 2 years ago, he passed away. He also was a good student of Yellapragada Subbarao. In fact, I want to make a correction here. Yellapragada Subbarao had inspired me to the same extent, or perhaps to a lesser extent, as Satya Reddy. But both of us shared one passion that Subbarao had, that is the basic research and applied research have no differences. What is basic research today will get applied later. In fact, it is the necessity is the mother of invention is a wrong aphorism. It is invention which is the mother of necessities. You invent, you discover, inventions follow. I think that was Subbarao's philosophy. In fact, I think Subbarao's method, Subbarao's name is very much associated with just a phosphorus estimation, which is all right, but as the techniques go. But I think the most profound of discoveries which were made by Subbarao using the technique of creatine phosphate and discovery of adenosine triphosphate. In fact, he should have, as I will show you on one of the slides, he should have got a Nobel Prize for that. But he missed it for some reason or the other. You know, there are not enough Nobel Prizes to reward every great discovery. It may be, it's not even an oversight. I think there was not enough Nobel Prizes to give. We should not argue about that. Now I would like to make a small correction. I was not a contemporary or new Subbarao personally. You know, by the time I graduated, Subbarao had passed. But we were intense scholars to really go through everything that he did, every paper that he published as students. And I think when I went to Boston, the first trip I made anywhere else outside of Boston was, I went to Cambridge, it is across the river in Boston, to see Subbarao's lab. And I had the good fortune of knowing one of his collaborators, Gerard Schmidt, who was a nucleic acid chemist who also was interested in phosphate estimation. And from him I have heard stories and narrations of Subbarao's triumphs and travails. I think he had great triumphs. He also had great difficulties and suffering in his personal life, because he faced during his work at Harvard extraordinary encouragement from some good scientists who really understood his value, who saw that he was starving as a vegetarian and tried to help him with the right kind of vegetables to eat, because I think he lost a lot of weight in the first few years he was there. He was in a very meager fellowship. He never became a faculty for a very long time. In fact, even that was a junior faculty only for research. At that time, the United States was not as liberal, as open to other races and other immigrants. So he had some difficulties, but none of that bothered him. So I had heard a lot of stories from friends and people whom I knew. And I also visited New Jersey, Rahway, to see the Lederle labs. And I had a number of friends who had known him. So that is my contact with Dr. Subbarao's legacy. Now today, I will concentrate on a topic which is a larger canvas of which Dr. Subbarao is a great part. Medicine, modern medicine in its glory today is what it is because the medicine, medical education, medical practice, research, everything in the United States was at the lowest point at the turn of the last century. You will not believe this. In fact, I would suggest, if you have not done it, to read at least the outline of what is known as the very famous Abraham Flexner's report on the state of medical education and research. It is a very, very revealing document. Abraham Flexner was an educator. He was not a physician. He was not a scientist, but he was a teacher, but an extraordinary teacher. Looking at the state of medical education, which was even worse than what it was. In fact, it was run by goons, mafia, and near dacoits. And they would give a degree within 1 or 2 years for them to go and practice if they gave them enough money. In fact, I think some of the narrations, I don't want to use much of my time to waste here, your time. But I think it is hilarious and also it is very revealing. So India is not too backward in that sense. I think we are catching up with them. I think we have to undo that. I think American medicine at the turn of last century was at its worst imaginable. And the Carnegie Foundation thought something should be done because Europe was really prospering. In Europe, science provided a very good base for medical education and medical practice. So they employed Flexner as an emissary to go to Europe, spend a few years, 3, 4, 5 years, traveling to all the countries and studying how medical education is carried out in Europe, how medical practices are, how hospitals are run, how the newly emerging sciences of physics and chemistry and some biology were the pillars of medicine, emerging medicine. This is at the beginning of the last century, 1905. The Flexner report came around that time. He made an extraordinary study. In fact, I think Flexner must have been a man with certain abilities which are absolutely uncommon, because his study revealed to him. In fact, I derived the title which I given, Useless Research, Helping a Lot of Useful Things in the History of Modern Medicine, is not my original title. It is taken from an article that Abraham Flexner wrote in Harper magazine in 1939. He makes the point, he asks, if you don't mind if I narrate some stories for you. The Eastman was the founder of Kodak Company. He asked Mr. Eastman, who do you think discovered the radio? So Eastman replies, it must be Marconi. Or he mentioned some names, you know, who discovered radios and marketed them. So Flexner says, no, none of these people were discoverers of radio, wireless. This was discovered by Maxwell, the great physicist, in 1895, when Maxwell wrote some mathematical equations enunciating the properties of electromagnetic forces, the connection between electricity and magnetism. And people really poo-pooed. A lot of them said, you know, what good is this mathematical formula? And the geniuses who came later to invent radio, wireless, and all the rest of telegraph, everything, they used Maxwell's principles, which were at that time considered useless. So that was Flexner's philosophy. He said, the European hospitals, every one of them had a microscope. In fact, it is pathology. Stains, you know, the American hospitals hardly had any, except the teaching hospitals on the East Coast. The entire country was voodoo medicine, most of it. So he comes back, and on the East Coast, east of United States, initiated changes in medical education, teaching and practices was a major milestone, the early phases. Science and research culture began the integration with hospitals. Every hospital hired a chemist, hired a physicist if possible, because of some instruments like the blood gases or calorimetry, or repairing microscopes, things like that. I think few things, optics. So they employed chemists and others in these hospitals, and always all these hospitals had a side room next to the ward where the residents would work. I think, to be honest, the discipline in medicine which laid the foundation for integration of science and inquiry was pathology. Because after the stains were discovered and the microscope was discovered, the insights into disease processes and what they mean, how to interpret them, how to relate them to the condition of health or disease began. And pathologists were very formidable. They didn't give up. I think till the dawn of physiology developing, along with biochemistry buttressing the physiological findings with hard chemistry, because I think later on it turns out, as I will describe to you, the lingua franca of medicine is indeed chemistry. Life is written in the language of chemistry. I think that was the theme of all research which has gone on in chemical research, in biochemical research, molecular biology, you call it whatever title you wish, that doesn't matter. Even cell biology today encompasses so much chemistry, and pathology is becoming molecular pathology. So I think chemistry, as a recognition of chemistry as a very important component, occurred in the hospitals in the East Coast. Subba Rao is a very, very important component of this revolution which occurred in American medical institutions of integrating chemistry into medicine. I think this is where I think we have to acknowledge what a star he was, because as I will show you in the next couple of slides, for example, you know, the people have always wondered, Schrodinger, the great physicist, he is the one who is the father of molecular biology. In fact, he put fundamental questions. What is life, he says, and then if not chemicals, if not molecules, if you go back to Aristotle, as far as Aristotle back, he said living organisms, nothing more than exquisite assemblage of machines. But then, taken seriously, if you take it lightheartedly, you know, it is not very appealing. But if you take it seriously, machines are changing in character. Now we have nanoscience which is going to influence a lot of machines. And I think if you should read some articles written by very, very, very outstanding engineers in information technology, where they say the future doctors will be engineers. Even that is worth looking at. Now I think I just have a slide how Dr. Subba Rao missed very narrowly the Nobel Prize. I was mentioned to you about ATP. The ATP discovery in 1929, the year I was born. Lohmann, a very great biochemist in Germany, working in Berlin, isolated ATP from muscle and liver extract. The elucidation of the structure, initially controversial, was in close competition with Fisk and Subba Rao. I have given three references. Subba Rao and Fisk is, the person with whom he used to work, where they published a few months earlier than Lohmann and group. Lohmann also didn't get a Nobel Prize because I think his colleague Meyerhoff had a Nobel Prize a few years earlier. Maybe that's why they didn't award them. Somehow these two people missed the Nobel Prizes. In fact, the ATP is the energy which the cellular engine really both manufactures, stores and dispenses, keeps it at its disposal for a myriad functions in the body. I think if you are depleted of ATP, you had it. Now I am really wanting to devote the next part of my talk to this usefulness of useless research in modern medicine. Useless research in quotes, that is because I think your spouses, if you are engaged in something very basic, they make fun of you. What is the value of your research? Or your relatives, or if you are in the marriage market, you know, you don't have much value if you have done an MBA or you have done an IAS. In my time it was IAS, now I think it is MBA. If you are engaged in research, the useless research is all basic research, useless in the common parlance. If you are purifying an enzyme from brain, and you are looking at how that enzyme is going to really take on two molecules and synthesize a third compound, what good is it to anybody? So I think the public perception about anything basic that you do in physics or chemistry or mathematics or any branch of knowledge is always considered useless because it has no immediate application. You write for a grant, you have the same problem. You have to really somehow contrive that there is a great usefulness. In fact, I am addressing this to students particularly. Please don't always think that the questions that you put for scientific the phenomena that you observe as useless, unless they have a little application where it will solve a human problem. Certainly they must solve a human problem. Many of our problems are solved because this revolution has occurred. But they will be solved only when your curiosity extends deeper and you contribute to knowledge. And in that pursuit, you should never have an apology. I think you have to really have that curiosity and the effort that you make to go so deep into it, things automatically will reveal themselves and they will have an application. even if you don't have you don't find an application for it, somebody else will. For example, once this Flexner report got accepted, I have listed these three, four examples as the contributions which began, how medicine began changing. You know, it is very interesting. You go back to history, you find in the landmark period was between 1905 and 1910. 1905 was the year when the Journal of Biological Chemistry was founded, and Follin was the first editor, and he writes a very erudite, lengthy single author paper on analysis of 30 normal urines. He looks at all the chemical components. Such beautiful description. I think some of you who have the, you must find some time and look at those papers to see the beauty of observation, recording, and then validating some of those to human condition. Then the laws governing the chemical composition of urines was written in the American Journal of Physiology in all 93 pages of eloquent scientific effort to really look at this. And the A Theory on the Protein Metabolism is another classical paper in the American Journal of Physiology written during this period, because that led to a great number of investigations leading to protein metabolism, how they are how the proteins break down, what the products are, one leads to the other. 93 eloquent pages. In fact, you know, one of my pastimes in the past was to really read these papers again and again for their classicism and what went behind those, the extraordinary curiosity. Now you will dismiss, you go around the corner, little pathology lab, some technician will take a test tube of urine and do it. That is not what it is. It was done in those years, in 1905, when they were looking for the chemical constituents in them, characterized them with the greatest of effort of creatine, creatinine, uric acid, urea, you know, methods for them. And in those days, what you had was a calorimeter or a digestion chemical flask, you know, where you could do that, or some organic chemical little equipment where you isolate a compound, crystallize them. In fact, this is one of the most eloquent narration. If you give a bird's eye view of what happened, because I don't have the time to go through all that, between 1900 and 2000, X-ray, for example, was discovered, not because I think they wanted to help doctors. I think while discovering X-rays as a physical phenomena, somebody's hand came in the way and they saw their bones. And I think then, you know, the applications began. Similarly, the method for blood glucose, which was done around 1905-07, these papers are also extraordinarily interesting. And Follin had a great contribution to make to this, so did Benedict. And the blood gases by Wanslake, in fact, I've seen those apparatuses in the Harvard Medical School in the basement. They really revolutionized, you know, respiration, understanding respiration physiology began with Wanslake's gas apparatus. Very simple things, they with glass blowing. And in fact, I think some of you should see how blood gases were estimated for on patients and how much blood they took in those days. And then began the interest in nitrogenous compounds, proteins, blood groups. You know, when World War began, blood transfusion became a necessity. So blood groups were investigated in the most, creative, imaginative manner possible. And that led to immunology. I think the field of immunology opened. And then came a very long period of nutrition. Nutrition dominated the scenario in biochemistry and medicine, physiology, because vitamins were discovered one after another. They were all found to be compounds. In fact, I think it was a great thing for them to discover these molecules could be synthesized, fed to rats deprived of it, humans who are deprived of this vitamin, and clinical features, clinical responses found for them. These are all classical papers. In fact, folic acid was first isolated by Esmond Snell in Wisconsin by taking two truckloads of spinach leaves in his cold room, working for 25 days. In the end, he got a few milligrams of folic acid isolated. I think you should read some of those classical papers. Once you had the identity of a vitamin like that, I think you could go further. You could do a lot of things. And the field of endocrinology began with insulin dependence and diabetes, and then opened the field of antibiotics, where Subbarao has spanned this entire period, though he unfortunately lived very short period from the time he went to the States in the 20s, I think he went, till he died in 1948, beginning with the implications of nitrogenous compounds, phosphorus compounds, energy compounds like ATP in fundamental biochemistry. He really worked on vitamins like folic acid, which led to methotrexate, you know, anti-cancer drugs, and also antibiotics. He covered till the end all these areas. Then began the great age. I don't want to go into details of this. DNA, genetics, genetic code, protein synthesis, immunology, immunochemistry, all these have dominated for these 100 years. And that is the golden period of modern medicine. How did these discoveries come about? All of them came about because of the sheer interest of these investigators who are not, some of them physicians, some of them not, but I think their passion to understand nature in the language of chemistry, fundamentally in the language of chemistry. They were all isolated. Even molecular biology in the DNA, for example, you know, I had a great fortune to visit Shargaff, an eminent chemist at Columbia University, who is the one who showed the ratios of the bases, A, T, G, C, by various laborious methods of estimation, chemical methods, chromatographic methods, estimation, and showed the ratio to be equal. In fact, that helped Watson and Crick when they built their model to really deduce what they did about the double helix. He made a contribution. Of course, again, he missed the Nobel Prize. Maybe they didn't want to give it to too many people. But then there were pioneers. Nucleic acid research in chemical research went on for almost 100 years. In fact, I have had the good fortune to have known them as peers and mentors with whom I have interacted. That was really one of the most glorious periods. So the last one century, from the Flexner report beginning, medical schools were the real meccas, real places of pilgrimage where these fundamental discoveries took place. I think we should not forget this. This history, all of you students, though you enjoy your molecular biology and cell biology and all the rest of it coming, because you have extraordinary instrumentation now which gives you the scope to do many things more. But in knowing history, you will get a great perspective. What you are doing, what is the importance of that? One century is not a very long time in human history. Please don't forget that. It may seem very long if you live 88 years. But I think if you consider the long history of human race, what has happened in medicine, where we can really understand the human condition in health and disease, what you have achieved is superior to any other, in my opinion, even launching to space spaceships. They are great in their own way. But I think going to the microcosm of life processes, to the single cell and understanding the myriad events, thousands of events in molecular terms, is one of the most exciting things that you can read. I think this history, the entire history that I have summarized in one slide, is enough material for you to really get inspired every day that you read it. I think this should form part of your self-inflicted or self-imposed curriculum. They may not teach you in the class, but as graduate students, I think we must really go through them. The profound influence of physics, chemistry, biology, and the developments in modern medicine thus happened over the last century. In fact, I have summarized this. For example, 8 Nobel Prizes in physics for clinical importance. They were all given for physics. But all of them, I won't read them, but I think you can read them. All these discoveries for which people were rewarded by Nobel Prizes, including Sir Raman. Now the Raman effect's application in medicine or biological research, biomedicine, is extraordinary now. In fact, it is even applied to screen whether you are, when you are going through security, Raman spectra is used for that, for detection of many things, NMR, all this. 10 Nobel Prizes in chemistry of clinical importance. All these people got Nobel Prizes in chemistry, but then they greatly influenced Nobel Prize. In fact, if you read the history of Nobel Prizes, you will really immediately understand how modern medicine has been evolved. That is very, 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 very essential. 5 Nobel Prizes in medicine arise from basic research. 6 Nobel Prizes in other fields to scientists with significant contribution to NMR. And the NMR today, or MRI as they call it in its application, there are 6 Nobel Prizes in other fields which were awarded to people, which has resulted in MRI, which is one of the most powerful tools today in imaging today in modern medicine. In fact, when you get to functional MRI and beyond, I think our brain research, our research into many things of a functional nature, imaging, when it gets molecular, I think it will be very, very exciting things. Now, I will give you summarize all this by providing you some evidence, scientific evidence, very well researched, which says the scientific basis for the support of medical bioscience. In fact, I am addressing this to ourselves, to people who run universities, people who give grants, people who recognize medical colleges. In fact, I was studying Dr. Geeta when I came here. This is perhaps the most ideal place for you to have a medical school, because the new paradigms which will come here will be based on basic sciences even more, because not all basic science is completed in this one century. Don't kid yourself. I think more to come, but they can be satisfied on campuses like this, because an integration of humanities, as I'll say subsequently, is going to happen in the future. This study was undertaken in the 70s by an anesthesiologist in the University of San Francisco in Berkeley, who argued, because Nixon was cutting every grant, thinking they were all using money for esoteric research, they had nothing to do with heart disease, nothing to do with cancer, they're not solving all problems. So Dr. Komro was his name. He was a physiologist who was also a professor of anesthesiology. He undertook a very large survey to prove the point that biomedical science, for all its advances till the 70s, has very strongly depended on scientific research, unrelated to any clinical problem. He took cardiovascular disease and associated clinical conditions as an example, and took the opinion of thousands of scientists all over the United States, and from them gathered data, and I will summarize it, because it's a very large study that the reference is available in Science. You can take a look at it. He took the advances in the clinical area, from cardiac surgery, vascular surgery, hypertension, coronary insufficiency, oral diuretics, a whole bunch of them, and he classified them as useful and useless according to my criteria, which are clinically oriented or not clinically oriented, and found, as you see on the last column, it is a little hidden, nearly 40% of research of the total were not clinically oriented research for the advances that have happened in all those areas. In fact, bypass surgery, beating heart surgery, all these that you talk about, heroic, depended 40% on research carried out which had nothing to do with it. In fact, you will be amused to hear some research which was done in entomology or birds, ornithology, basic work, microbiology, plant sciences. In fact, today I don't have the time, because I can tell you that much. From plants, what you can learn about their effect as drugs, composites. In Ayurveda, for example, most of the effects are found with composites rather than isolated molecules. Western medicine is obsessed with single molecule giving a particular pharmacological action. All right, there's no issue with that. But I think the important thing is to look at plants as sources of therapeutic agents from another perspective, what they do. That is a science that has to be really made a new science, where I think we have to really find out the truth. For example, curcumin is a great example. Curcumin has an extraordinary effect, but you can't really accept it in the Western medicine, because one molecule doesn't increase the blood concentration. There's a challenge. I think the future will tell us if that is tackled by a scientific approach. Maybe we open a whole vista for therapeutic agents from our ancient systems. But I think that has to be scientifically investigated. So this particular study of 529 key articles is an extraordinary example of what basic science in chemistry, physics, mathematics, take anything, any natural science, influences medicine. So I think I quote a very famous biochemist by name Arthur Kornberg, who got Nobel Prize for the discovery of DNA synthesis. he says that that is the lingua franca of medicine. And you look at the concept of biochemical lesions, all of them carry molecules, either is hypo or hyper, all of them. In fact, this list can run into hundreds. What does it indicate? That means you can measure them, and they're related to a disease where their elevated level or a lower level has a significance in terms of disease. In fact, we carried out this work in Kolar, you know, where I work in a small, very modest genetic lab. This condition is known as acquired recessive ichthyosis, familial ichthyosis, where the child is born with defect in the cross-linking of the collagen. And this is one of those fatal mutations where the tryptophan is mutated to glycine. We could, you know, this is very common now, mutation analysis is done. This is a child which passed away within 6 months. They don't survive because the skins don't cross-link and they get, you know, wounds, ulcers, they pass away. Now, what is the thing which has happened here? I think if you do a bioinformatic kind of analysis on this, I am very rapidly running through this because it's an involved science. When you do a bioinformatic analysis, the intact enzyme tryptophan 187, which has been mutated, keeps the active site loci, local, you know, region in the molecule intact, so that reaction of cross-linking can occur using this enzyme. And when the mutation occurs, when glycine, you can see the picture that is given, the entire region where the active site has to be compact and receive the substrate is broken. So this is a fatal mutation. In fact, in this condition, there are nearly 147 mutations discovered. This is molecular. This kind of a thing is a molecular medicine at its best, where you really explain a lot of events based on structure and function. In fact, in this area, the contribution of one of our own scientists, G.N. Ramachandran, for the X-ray crystallography of proteins, I think it is one of the most leading contributions made. I think we should also perhaps look at it. It has influenced, in fact, on collagen structure. Ramachandran's plots, you know, that he really invented and discovered, should have earned him any prize. Again, not enough Nobel prizes. That doesn't matter. Now, the understanding of drug action similarly is only 100 years old. Before that, opium, cannabis, ergot, cinchona bark, oil, all these were used for thousands of years with good effect. I think what is needed is a scientific validity. So I think the important thing to summarize all these things will be to have curiosity, use chemistry, and find cures. And biochemistry really very heavily depends on one other branch of biology, that is enzymology. I'm not saying this with bias, because almost every event that happens of transformation, synthesis, breakdown, regulation, everything in a living system, whether it is a mosquito or an elephant or ourselves, depends on enzymes acting in their catalytic properties with precision, with speed, with regulation, with everything. I think they are really, one can get so eloquent and poetic about it, because medicine's foundations have been laid to a great extent on understanding. When a mutation occurs in an enzyme like I described earlier, it is not compatible with life. Or there are a number of mutations with which we can also live. So now, the genomic period from 1990 to now, many new specialties in biology have come about. Now, you know, one thing we have to have caution. A lot of people complain that lab methods tend to make us forget the patient altogether in the excitement of the scientific things that we are so fascinated with. This was told by one of a very famous physician in Canada in 1924. In 1924, he must have had hardly about 8 tests that he can do. But now we have 800 or 1,000. It must be much more. Note the date of the comment. It is 1924. But I would say that it is not a correct thing. I think economically looking, maybe you should not bleed the patient. You know, there should not be profits. But in terms of understanding a disease or a healthy condition, today we are moving towards a situation where it is not a battery of tests. In time, static as well as dynamic. In fact, I'll have another slide a few minutes later, are very important for us to know. I'll skip this. I think this is to emphasize the father of British biochemistry, Hopkins. I think Hopkins, you should read about Hopkins. He was a leader in nutrition, enzymology, and every aspect of... I also will tell you how metabolism or interconversion of compounds can be taken in done simple experiments and how they have performed meaning. This is a piece of work I did long ago in the 1970s on glutamic acid. Glutamic acid is a common amino acid. It gives rise to another compound called oxoproline. This is by elimination of a molecule of water and an internal acylation. Now this compound is supposed to be very inert for almost 100 years. Though it occurs in large quantities in our system, nobody had bothered about this. So a very simple experiment was designed where a rat in a cage, metabolic cage, which is the technique of Winehouse and Friedman, this particular apparatus which anybody can make, a high school graduate can make this if you teach him glass blowing, but the effects are profound. You collect the expired carbon dioxide, you collect the feces and the urine, and then sacrifice the animal and look for the labeled compound. You use the isotopically labeled compound. You can say whether that compound is a metabolite or not metabolite. These were discovered way back in 1951, and afterwards a flood of things happened. So I applied this technique in Mysore, in the Central Food Research Laboratory, where I was working on children with malnutrition, who also were not metabolizing but excreting a large number of large amount of oxoproline. So the results of this experiment are shown in this. You will see within a half an hour or 40 minutes expired carbon dioxide shows the maximum radioactivity. That means that compound oxoproline, which was considered inert for 100 years, could be proven by a very simple experiment using an isotope. And then see the consequences of this. The consequences of this are, this work was quoted in the literature. The new cycle was described for gamma glutamate cycle. This oxoproline getting converted to by oxoprolinase to glutamate. This cycle was completed because of this reaction was discovered by us. And soon after, what followed was very interesting. Soon after, within 3-4 years, in metabolic acidosis, hemolytic anemia, CNS dysfunction, more than 70 patients were reported in 50 families where they had this deficiency in the enzyme and massive amounts of this compound being in the urine. Once a method was discovered for estimating oxoproline, this became a very clinically accepted method for screening for patients. In fact, in 1970, these patients were described in Norway, Sweden. Now, oxoproline screening is part of newborn screening. I think somebody mentioned about glycated hemoglobin in Jastok Hospital. In the clinical lab, which was a service-oriented lab, we played around with glycated hemoglobin and found a very simple chemical method. I won't go into details on that, which we could offer where diabetics are 15 rupees in those days. 1-5. And this is the correlation with mean blood glucose and glycated hemoglobin, published way back in 1973-74. We were the first to do this in India. Not for any other reason, I am really projecting this for the young students to understand. If you put serious questions after study and understanding what you can do, there are very simple methods by which you can make very profound, valuable contributions. Now, what has happened? Modern medicine has come to a stage where the education, practice and research is at crossroads, because it is to look for a new paradigm. Because with all these tests, with all this technology, we are not happy. Things are going wrong. Where are they going wrong? Because medical science in its present state doesn't have an answer for many questions. For example, Helicobacter pylori, one of those things, one of those organisms which inhabit our stomach, our gastric system, is present in many people, but it is only in some which get symptoms. Similarly, you know, in breast cancer, psychosocial situations a lot of times relate to occurrence of myocardial infarction. In fact, there is a very simple thing in clinical trials. You have a placebo effect. You give the drugs which you test to some patients, and you give some to others in which there is no drug. There is some palatable chalk powder. But they respond, 4 or 5 of them respond out of 20. I think we ignore it. We say it's a placebo effect and ignore it. What is working on their mind? A good example here is, now you know these kind of headlines appear in newspapers very often. Check if you suffer from living at office syndrome, which is stress. They say lack of physical activity, salt rich diet, processed foods, alcohol, they all contribute to the incidence of diabetes in the young people. And then they say stress. What is stress? I think nobody can really answer that question. Now I am wanting to tell you, there are certain inputs that we get in our minds by external agencies or internal, which have an effect. Medical science has come to a dead end because there is no word to explain in our vocabulary, in the medical vocabulary, what is stress. I am giving you this example. These are two women in Germany, both married. One lady, her husband goes to East Germany to visit his mother, and somehow gets stuck there because before he comes, the East Berlin Wall. In the old days, there was a wall. So he tells his wife, "No, I'm not able to come back. So I will today or tomorrow or day after, I will try to escape through some route somebody has told, and we are escaping. If somebody shoots me, you won't get a call. I will tell you on that day I am trying this attempt to escape. If you don't get a call, maybe around 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the morning, if you get a call, that means I am alive. I have escaped. If you don't get a call, that means I am gone." Now, there is another lady whose husband gets a massive heart attack one morning, so she takes him to the hospital, young lady. And he is treated in the hospital with every care that you can bestow on. He is not revived. And it is late, 10:30, 11 in the night. So the doctors tell her, there seems to be some glimmer, but we can't tell what happens. But we are really very concerned about you. You spent the whole day in such agony and anxiety. I think it is time you go home and get some rest, sleep. We won't call you if he recovers. But if there is no hope and is going, then we will give you a call. Same time. So both women get a call. What are the reactions in these two women? Both respond to a rush of endocrinological and neurophysiological responses. Both of them. Because adrenaline in both of them go up, the heart rate will go up, blood pressure will go up. But in one person, there is an emotion of joy and relief. And in the other person, there is despair and mourning. The lady who lost the husband is in despair, mourning. She also gets psychosomatically very relevant and understandable physical symptoms, collapses. The other lady is full of joy and relief. But you measure all her chemistry, they're all the neurons are firing, neurochemistry, metabolism is going on and all the rest of it. Now there is no word in medicine to describe these responses. We know we can make these observations very accurately, but we know no way we can tell anything. This area is called biosemiotic approach to problems. What is biosemiotics? It is a field of study in biology, and semiotics is the production and interpretation of science, codes and information. It is not science yet, because scientists won't accept it so easily. But then one has to really look at information technology, look at philosophy, look at many other psychology, many other things, and perhaps evolve some knowledge, understanding and depth where it is possible this paradigmic shift in the scientific view of life can occur, because the living systems are all self-regulatory and informational inputs are constantly happening to us. Because why do we really feel very good with some doctors when we go to them, and with some we can't? We don't go. We avoid some hospitals, we go to some hospitals. There are many essential regulations and off biological processes. this activating the system receptors is possible. It's quite possible this kind of information inputs, either positive or negative, may activate some system receptors and receptors that convert them to message and initiate physiological changes. And these messages are sent through our system are themselves etiological factors. But then, you know, there is enough anecdotal and even, hard evidence for this kind of a thing happening in people, but it has not been integrated into medicines. The present paradigm in medicine is, because of all the chemistry, physics, computer science, everything going into medicine, it is Newtonian and it is reductionist, monocausal. For us, today it is monocausal. But present day new paradigm will have to evolve in the light of a large number of data which are really accumulating in genomics, in proteomics, in metabolomics. I don't know how many more omics are going to come, but I think it is evolving in all of them. So perhaps, you know, in the future, mathematics is biology's next microscope, because we will have massive data which requires a mathematical approach to really put them on systems. Only better. Biology, not that the microscope will go, certainly it won't go, but I think we will have an additional microscope. Biology is mathematics next physics. Computational systems biology is the next physiology. This is happening already. In fact, I think now measuring thousands of glucose determinations in a diabetic, putting them in a systems biology to understand responses is already beginning. So maths is a very important subject. You can't avoid it. I think you have to really acquire, because maths is a language. So the systems biology is evolving. I won't go into details. The new paradigm will go back to the original thing where these questions were put. What is life? If not chemicals, if not molecules of water, matter, in addition to this, what else is life, is a question that it has to be answered. The machines also has to be redefined. For example, when does life end? When enzymes start stopping working? When does it begin? When does it end? And when it is continuity in living, what are the states in which these inputs have what kind of effects on them? So these very profound questions in medicine addressing the human has to come. And that is going to come from a very new science, because we won't accept anything which is not evidence-based, certainly not. If that is the case, I think the challenge is for people like Subbarao, because I think in Subbarao's life, I think this part of it I wanted to say for the last, he was not only a great scientist, very curiosity driven, very ingenious in his approach to experiments and so forth, but he was also very philosophical and religious, spiritual. In fact, spiritual is a better word. I think he always, none of these journeys he took in science were attached to any material things that he wanted. He never sought anything. I think for him, humanity was a very important thing, and towards the end, he was seeking spiritual solace in whatever he did. In fact, I think he was a member of some very, very important, profound spiritual bodies in New Jersey, and some writings in that direction are also available. So I think he must have really been delving into these realms of the human condition. Human condition is great chemistry, it is great physics, but also it has dimensions which influence all these chemistries and physics by some events which happen in us due to perhaps a new science. I think with that kind of a hope, if any of you can fill that vacuum in a campus where humanities and sciences coexist so beautifully, I think it will be a great day. Having said this, I end my little rambling. And I thank you for the extraordinary opportunity I had to really speak spontaneously on this, because I feel all this myself. Thank you very much indeed.
If you have visited the Science Planetarium, Birla Planetarium, an overview of the planets that you see is the experience that I've had listening to you, sir. Looking at a human body from a biochemist or physics or a social persons and the history. Professor Ratnakar used to say, if you don't know history, you won't understand future, or you won't create future.
Thank you.
complete profile of the university.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah. Oh, I would like to keep in touch with the university.
Yes.
And I now invite Nagaraju to propose a vote of thanks.
Dr. P. R. K. Krishnaswamy Garu and Honorable Professor Vice Chancellor Professor Apparagaru, Dean School of Medical Sciences, Dr. Geeta Vemaganti, respected guests, my dear colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I deem it a great privilege to extend a vote of thanks on this occasion on behalf of School of Medical Sciences, University of Hyderabad. Vice Chancellor Professor Apparao Garu for extending his support for this Yellapragada Subba Rao Memorial Lecture and grace the occasion. Thank you, sir. Dean School of Medical Sciences, Professor Geeta Vemaganti for making this memorial lecture possible. Thank you, ma'am. And I also take this opportunity to extend our most sincere thanks to all our guests who have come from different organizations and schools and our faculty to grace the occasion to extend the support. Thank you all. We express our sincere thanks to our PRO office for helping us with the web and the media coverage. And I'm also thankful to staff at our Dean's office, Ms. Beena, Mr. Murthy, Mr. Shiva, Mr. Jayant, Mr. Mallesh, and Ms. Meha for helping the administrative tasks and other logistics. And I'm also thankful to the staff at Sir C.V. Raman's Auditorium for their support with AV and the media.